Okay, welcome to the second part of this session for the Bowen Award lectures. And the second recipient for 2010 is Hans Kepler. Hans is a professor of experimental geophysics at Bayreuth Geo-Institute. And the Bowen Award for 2010 recognizes his outstanding contributions as an experimentalist, complemented by strong theoretical analysis. His major achievements include studies of water in nominally anhydrous minerals, research in supercritical fluids, and studies on trace element partitioning. Like Sam, his letters of nomination speak volumes of somebody with a huge reputation and who has made fundamental contributions. As I mentioned earlier, he will receive the award at the VGP reception this evening at 6:30. That's in Salon 9 of the Marriott. The award ceremony will take place before you are allowed to drink, I should just emphasize. And that starts at 6:30, and you'll hear there a fuller citation for Hans. So please join us there to celebrate his achievements. So finally, if I'd ask us Hans to come to the podium and present his lecture. I'd have great pleasure in awarding you the certificate for the Bowen Award lecture.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Steve, for the kind introduction, and hello and good morning to everybody. As announced, I will now talk about show some new insights into volatiles in Earth's interior. And for the first half of my talk, I will essentially look at water and halogens in subduction zones. Now, there is absolutely no question that water is extremely important for the formation of arc magmas. And I think what's happening down there is in principle very well understood. This is a picture which you find in many textbooks. Hydrated oceanic crust is subducted. Various dehydration reactions are going on. Fluids are being released. They infiltrate here into the mantle wedge, cause melting, and this is what you see in arc volcanoes on the surface. However, there is one thing which is actually not very well understood in this system. How do the fluids actually migrate here from the subducted slab to the zone of melting? Many people seem to believe that this migration primarily occurs through some kind of channelized flow, in such a way that the fluid travels around some channels or fractures with very little interaction with the surrounding mantle peridotite, which essentially implies that the fluid is chemically isolated from the surrounding, and what you later absorb in the zone of melting is pretty much some unchanged fluid as it has been released from the subducted slab. But there is, of course, another possibility that fluid might migrate by some kind of diffusive and pervasive flow, which would imply that it interacts with most of the material in the mantle wedge, which in turn could mean that what you are actually finding in the arc magmas, the trace element budget of the arc magmas, this could, to a large degree, be scavenged from the mantle wedge if this kind of flow style here applies. And what I'm now going to do is to use some new data on halogen partitioning between aqueous fluids and other mantle minerals in order to address the predominant style of fluid migration through the mantle wedge. These were experiments done mostly by my PhD student, Diego Bernini, and in principle, the experiments are quite simple. We crystallize typical upper mantle minerals such as olivine, pyroxenes, garnet from some starting mixture containing glasses or oxides together with water and chloride or fluoride. Standard piscilinder experiments. The only thing which is not standard here is the analytics, because the halogen concentrations in these samples are so small that you have to use SIMS method in order to measure this, and this was done at Geoforschungszentrum Potsdam with the kind help of Michael Wiedenbeck. Okay, reaction products here look very simple. You get some relatively large crystals of various upper mantle minerals which have been crystallizing in the presence of a saline fluid, so these things are certainly saturated with chloride or with fluoride, depending on what kind of type of experiment did we do. So let's have a quick look at experimental results. This here is chlorine. This is concentration in the mineral versus salinity of the fluid. And these data are quite amazing for two reasons. First, you see that the chlorine concentration in mental minerals is exceedingly low. It's far below 1 ppm of chlorine, even in equilibrium with a fluid containing something like 28% of NaCl. So chlorine is exceedingly incompatible. The other thing which is interesting, normally you would expect some sort of proportionality between concentration in the mineral and concentration in the fluid. But what you see here is something very different. In fact, it looks that you have reached some sort of intrinsic saturation limit in the mineral. You're probably filling some sort of intrinsic defect, and you just cannot stuff any chlorine more into the sample if you increase the salinity of the fluid. If you translate this into partition coefficient, this means partition coefficients are extremely high, something like 10 to 4 to 10 to 6. Okay, so chlorine is exceedingly incompatible. Fluorine basically shows a similar behavior. The only difference is, in particular for olivine, the concentration which you reach are actually quite a bit higher, several hundred ppm. For other upper mantle minerals, they are in the range of some 10 of ppm. Still, fluorine is incompatible, but not quite as much as chlorine. Okay, what can we now do with this data? Well, we can do this. If you release some fluids from the subducted slab and these travel through the mantle wedge to the zone of melting where these arc magmas are being produced, what will happen? Well, very simple. Chlorine will go through there without any change because chlorine is so exceedingly incompatible. Okay, there will be no absorption, no significant absorption of chlorine when these fluids travel through the mantle wedge. But when you're at something like 3 GPA, water solubility in mantle minerals is quite significant, something in the order of 1,000 ppm, which would mostly in pyroxenes, not so much in olivine. This means that as the fluid is traveling through the mantle wedge, you're actually absorbing a lot of the water. And since chlorine remains constant, essentially you're concentrating these halide solutions. You may start with something with very low concentration here, and you end up with something with quite high halogen concentration that is then being absorbed in the zone of melting. So the idea here is quite simple. If we have some idea about the starting concentration and the final concentration of chlorine in the fluid, we can in principle calculate the ratio of fluid to rock which is required to produce this effect which we see here. Okay, the problematic thing is here. There are some data and literature, mostly by Scambaluri and his group, of fluid inclusions from serpentinites, which are believed to be representative for the fluids which are released by dehydration reactions from the subducted slab. There are relatively limited data, but if you believe them, they suggest some relatively low salinity of the fluid. We have, on the other hand, very good data on the chlorine-to-water ratio of the fluid that was absorbed here in the zone of melting, because there are very good data on the volatile content of primitive melt inclusions from arc basalts. And, okay, during normal mantle melting, when you produce a mob, there's very little water and very little halogens entering the melt. Here you find orders of magnitude more water and more halogens, so it's a safe assumption that this excess water and halogens simply comes from the fluid. So the fluid is being absorbed and the chlorine over water ratio, which you later find in the melt, is essentially the chlorine to water ratio of the absorbed fluid. So with these assumptions, I can make some very simple calculation. I can calculate now how the chlorine over water ratio will change when the fluid is percolating through the mantle wedge as a function of the rock fluid ratio, the ratio of rock which has been equilibrating with the fluid. And here are different curves shown. They correspond to different initial concentrations, less than 1 weight percent of NaCl in the fluid, up to 4 weight percent of NaCl in the fluid. And shown here is also the chlorine to water ratio, which you typically find in primitive arc basalts. This is a compilation from many data from throughout the entire world, and most of the data actually cluster here rather close to the upper limit. So if you just take these data as they are, what you see here is that in order to get something, some chlorine to water ratio here close to the upper limit recorded by primitive melt inclusions of arc basalts, you need to have a rock over fluid ratio of something like 1,000 up to 4,000 or even more. What does this mean? Okay, one can now do some fancy calculations. I rather prefer to do some very simple back on the envelope calculation, which, however, gives you the right idea what's going on here. I make some simplifying assumptions. I assume that in the moment when the slab has arrived down here below the arc, it only contains something like 1 weight percent water, could be a little bit less, a little bit more, but it's a reasonable number. This obviously corresponds to a water over rock ratio of 1 to 100. And I want to produce during percolation of the through the mantle wedge water to rock ratio of something like 1 to 1,000. Make another assumption, I assume, okay, certainly a simplification, that the velocity of the plate as it is going down here is pretty much the same as the velocity of the corner flow of the mantle peridotite here. In other words, I assume as once I put in a new piece of subducted slab, in the same moment I put on top of this piece of subducted slab a new column of mantle peridotite. It's a simplifying assumption, but for the sake of argument, it's actually quite okay. Now, what does this then mean? Well, very simple. If I have here a subducted crust which is 6 kilometers thick and has a water to rock ratio of 1 to 100, and I want to have a water rock ratio of 1 to 1,000, it simply means I need to have a 10 times larger column of rock on top of this. So I must have above these 6 kilometers of subducted oceanic crust a 60 kilometer column of mantle peridotite which completely interacts with the fluid to produce the observed salinity change. And it's clear what this means. I mean, the arc here has an average depth of 120 kilometers. Zone of melting is here somewhere in the middle. It essentially shows that I have pervasive fluid flow. I have complete equilibration of the fluid going through pretty much the entire mantle peridotite material until it reaches the zone of melting. Okay, this in turn could imply that a lot of the trace elements which you find in there actually do not necessarily come from the dehydrating slab. They may have been scavenged to some significant degree from the mantle wedge. Now, this brings me to a slightly different topic, the mobility of trace elements in subduction zone fluids. And this is work mostly done with Diego Bernini and Enrico Bali. And okay, there's a lot of experimental work around these days, and most experiments that are being carried out in this field use some method like this, either some double capsule technique where you have here solid material out in the outer capsule, you trap the fluid, or very popular these days, a diamond trap technique where you have a solid in equilibrium with a fluid and you trap the fluid basically in the cavities between some grains of diamond powder. These experiments are very popular. There are lots of studies around which basically gives you the entire trace element composition of any fluid you want to have as a function of pressure and temperature, and it seems that all of the problems are solved. However, okay, despite the popularity of this experimental approach, I have some doubts that what you are measuring here actually really accurately records reality. And it's very easy to demonstrate this. I show you here a view of a diamond inodal cell experiment. This here is water, aqueous fluid, and in here is a chip of andesite glass, which is now dissolving at increasing temperature. This is basically exactly the same thing what is done in these piston cylinder or multi-anvil experiments. It's just done in a diamond anvil cell, so you can directly see what's happening. So what is happening as you increase temperature is now you're dissolving this andesite glass, but there's also something else happening, because if you increase temperature, you suddenly nucleate some secondary phases. And this is not surprising, because typically in these experiments, you start with something, glassy starting material of high Gibbs free energy. High Gibbs free energy means you produce initially a very much oversaturated solution. This will produce some precipitation of stable minerals. These here are probably amphiboles. And what you're then measuring later in your diamond trap is this up here. It's a mixture of stable minerals together with a fluid. It's by no means a fluid composition. Okay? This is a general problem in these experiments. Why does this happen? Because in order to produce the stable mineral assemblage, usually you start with something which is middle stable, which has high Gibbs free energy. You could avoid this by starting right away with the stable minerals, then you would not get this oversaturation effect, but then you have another problem. If you start with stable minerals such as pyroxenes or olivine, you can only reach an equilibrium trace element distribution by diffusing the trace elements through the lattice of these minerals. And unfortunately, in most cases, this is such a slow process that it won't happen in the average lifetime of a PhD student, and therefore this kind of experiment is not being done or is not doable. Therefore, I think you can do such experiment, and if you do it properly, you can get some approximate idea what might be going on. But for really reliable and high precision measurements of mobility of trace elements in fluids, we have to do it in a different way. And this is the way how we are doing it. It's much more tedious, but it's something which probably produces much more reliable results. We do this in two steps. First, we take some saturating phase, for example, zircon for zirconium. If you want to look at zirconium solubility, we measure then the solubility of this trace element in minerals in equilibrium with this phase. Okay, this is no problem, it's a standard experiment. We do a second experiment where we measure the solubility, let's say, of zircon in the fluid, and from the ratio of these two solubilities, we calculate the actual partition coefficients. Okay, what is the advantage of this? Advantage is, first, I start with stable phases. Therefore, I cannot possibly get any oversaturation effects. This is not possible. Secondly, what I do here is a simple dissolution in an aqueous fluid. There is no diffusion in a solid state involved, and therefore I can reach equilibrium easily. Okay? Now, these experiments here on the left-hand side are relatively trivial. For the experiments on the right-hand side, we use a variety of techniques, mostly two of them. One is the hydrothermal diamond anvil cell. Nice thing about this, you can look into the sample chamber, you can directly see what's going on, and this method is actually extremely sensitive. It's sensitive down to the ppm level. Because what we are doing is, we just take the gasket in the cell, fill in some water, fill a tiny chip of, for example, zircon, together with quartz here to buffer silica activity. This tiny chip of zircon you can measure very precisely under the microscope, and then you just heat this up and measure when this zircon grain here disappears, and you have measured the solubility. You can also demonstrate attainment of equilibrium when you cool down. You should get precipitation again. When you heat up, you should get dissolution. All of these things can be nicely tested. And the sensitivity of this method is really amazing. Here are some data for zircon solubility. You can see you can measure easily solubility somewhere in the level of 1 ppm with quite high precision. And what you see here is basically typical for all really modern studies of high field strength element solubility in aqueous fluids. All of these studies show that the solubility of these high field strength elements in aqueous fluids is actually very, very low, and therefore the depletion of these elements in arc magmas is certainly simply related to their low mobility in the fluid. So the diamond cell is very useful for lots of these experiments, but it has its limitations. Because when you're looking at a system where you have to control oxygen fugacity, this is not something you can easily do in a diamond cell. But here we can use something else. We again do a simple dissolution experiment. We just take a saturating phase, dissolve it in water, and then we trap fluid inclusions in a normal piece cylinder or multi-anvil experiment by putting a quartz or olivine crystal in there. This will recrystallize during the experiment, trap some fluid inclusions. Then you have fluid inclusions which have been trapping the fluid at high temperature. They may have been precipitating some daughter minerals during cooling, here for example uranium oxide in the study of uranium oxide solubility, but this does not matter because you can laser ablate the entire thing and get a composition of the entire fluid inclusion. I again show you some result of one such study. Okay. This here is a study of uranium oxide solubility in fluids under different oxygen fugacity. Here is iron-iron oxide, very reducing. Then it's getting more oxidizing. Yellow points are rhenium-rhenium oxide, very oxidizing. Note, vertical scale is logarithmic, and horizontal scale is salinity. Several interesting observations. Uranium mobility depends on both oxidation state and on fluid salinity. However, you have to look carefully. Actually, when you are at very reducing conditions, even high salinity does not change the solubility of uranium oxide. And this is very well understood. This is related to the two oxidation states of uranium, uranium 4+ and uranium 6+. If you have only uranium 4+, you have low solubility and you do not form chloro complexes. If you have uranium 6+, you do form chloro complexes and then you get this very strong, in fact, two orders of magnitude increase in solubility. What we've also been doing, we've been doing similar measurements for sorium. Sorium does not show this change in oxidation state. Therefore, the sorium solubility is always down here, independent of redox state and independent of salinity. We have also measured uranium and sorium solubility in minerals, so we can basically calculate partition coefficients. I will not go into the details of this. I just show you some interesting application. Okay, these are compilations of, I think, 1,700 chemical analyzes of arc magma compositions, uranium over sorium ratio of arc magmas from all over the world. This is plotted over lanthanum over ytterbium, basically some proxy for degree of partial melting. Blue dots are arc magmas. You see uranium over sorium ratio can be quite high, and this is something characteristic for arc magmas, because if you compare this to rift volcanics, they do not show this. Also, you can do some simple fractional melting calculation. If you calculate fractional melting composition, you see there's no way you can produce this uranium over sorium enrichment by simple fractional melting. But with our data, we can now predict what will happen if you now absorb some fluid in there. And here we can now play with two parameters, or with several parameters. What happens if you just absorb some reducing fluid buffered by iron-iron oxide? Well, then both uranium and sorium solubility are very low. You're basically not changing anything. You cannot explain this pattern. What if you're absorbing now more oxidizing fluids, but still which do not contain any halogens? Still, conclusion is the same. Solubility of both uranium and sorium is so low that you have very little net effect. You cannot explain this high uranium over sorium ratio. You can only explain this if you really assume both oxidizing conditions and high fluid salinity. Here I have done a calculation with 48% of NaCl in the fluid and up to 5 to 10% of saline fluid added. And then you can nicely explain why you get these elevated uranium over sorium ratios. So the bottom line from this is, here's an independent line of evidence which shows not only that fluids in subduction zones, at least those producing these high uranium over sorium ratios, must be quite oxidized. This line of evidence also shows that the fluid in the moment when it's absorbed in a zone of melting actually has quite a high salinity. This does not necessarily mean that it already has a high salinity when it's coming out of the subducting slab, but it will become concentrated during the percolation through the mantle wedge, because chlorine is pretty much completely incompatible, and when the fluid is then being absorbed in a zone of melting, usually the salinity will be quite high. So now I leave subduction zones behind and I switch to something completely different. I will now talk a little bit about noble gases, and particular noble gases in the deep earth mantle. Now, this is work which is almost completely done by my colleagues Yaroslav Sergeyevich Sheka, so normally he should be standing here, present his results. Unfortunately, he did not get the Bowen Award yet, so I have to do it for him this time. But if you want to talk to him yourself, he will have a poster on Friday afternoon, so you can also talk to the person who has been doing all the experiments here. So what is so interesting about argon and xenon? Well, several things. If you breathe, what you breathe is 1% of argon. It's nearly only argon-40, which is produced by radioactive decay of potassium-40. If you calculate how much argon-40 should have been accumulated over Earth's history, what you find is that only half of this argon, which should be here, is actually in the atmosphere. So there must be half of the argon sitting somewhere in the deep Earth's interior. Where is this argon sitting? Other interesting observation, if you look at the relative abundance of stable noble gas isotopes, for example, argon-36 and other noble gases, in general, for the heavy noble gases, the abundance pattern of the Earth pretty much follows that in chondrites, but there's a discrepancy for xenon. Okay, the xenon is less abundant on the Earth by about a factor of 10, and there have been all sorts of wild hypotheses around to explain this. Number of people are suggesting, well, the xenon is here, you just have to look more carefully, then you will find it either in glacier ice, sediments, gas hydrates, or wherever. Unfortunately, so far, nobody has found it. Other people say xenon is probably sitting in a core. It's even more difficult to check this one. And then there are some rather convoluted models which explain this depletion by a combination of several processes, but again, I would claim there is no obvious physical explanation why this xenon is missing. So, most people would probably agree, not 100%, but 95% of people would agree that under upper mantle conditions, noble gases are extremely incompatible, so they are not being dissolved in a significant amount in mantle minerals. But how about the lower mantle? Surprisingly, nobody so far has been looking at this, despite the fact that there is some obvious mechanism how noble gases could be hiding there. Because the most important constituent of the lower mantle is aluminum-bearing magnesium silicate perovskite. And there are now two ways how you can put aluminum into the perovskite. You can just take one magnesium, one silicon, replace it by two aluminum. Then you get this here, this so-called Chamac substitution. This is not interesting because structure does not change. However, it's also very well documented that you can have another substitution mechanism. You replace silicon 4+ by aluminum 3+. Then you need to have some oxygen vacancies in order to produce charge balance. I mean, if I were a noble gas atom, I would right away jump in there because this is the right place to go. It's just perfect sites to go and electrical neutrality is fulfilled. This would be the perfect place to put in a noble gas atom. Okay, so this is what we have been looking at. We have been looking at noble gas solubility in these aluminum-bearing perovskites, and later we have also been looking at noble gas solubility in pure magnesium silicate perovskite, because even without aluminum, you can get these oxygen vacancies if you have a deficiency of silicon. Okay? And I will show you now data mostly on argon, but later on I will also say something about xenon. Okay, how do we do these experiments? Well, difficult part here is you have to do high-pressure experiments under noble gas saturation. So one part of the trick is to use some strange gas loading device where you can actually fill noble gases, 100 bars of argon, into some platinum capsule and seal it under pressure. And then what we did in the first series of experiments is we took these capsules, which contain some glass, some argon, put them first in a piston cylinder press, make them some argon-saturated glass, which contains some several hundred ppm of argon, use these then as starting material for multi-anvil experiments, crystallize in the, under lower mantle conditions the perovskite, and then look at it with electron microprobe. Now, noble gas people will probably laugh at this. Why would you measure noble gases with electron microprobe? You would have to be very optimistic about this to find anything, but let's try to be optimistic. Okay. First experiments, okay, we had lots of failed experiments because we did not go into the perovskite stability field by accident. We made all sorts of phase ringwoodite, ilmenite, stishovite, periclase, corundum. We never found any argon in there. Okay. We also made majorite, magnesium silicate with garnet structure. I show you this picture because you can see some nice large cavities in there which show that this sample was definitely argon saturated. Again, there's nothing in there. But if we go to perovskite, in particular, if you go to perovskite, where from the chemical analyzer we see this must contain some oxygen vacancies, then suddenly we find argon. 50 to 350 ppm of argon, pretty much the same what we had put into the study material. There's a large scatter in the analyzer of the argon content, but this can be explained if you look closely at the sample. This here is a picture of one of these perovskites, and you probably won't see this in the back. These here are microprobe electron beam spots, and if you look carefully around these spots, there are a large number of dark bubbles. And these bubbles were not there before chemical analysis, so obviously this sample is degassing under the electron beam, which explains the large scatter which we get in the analytical data. Of course, we were very careful to make sure that there's absolutely no bubbles or nothing in the perovskite itself. For example, we have been looking at with TEM, there are no phases, foreign phases, bubbles or anything detectable. Still, these experiments as they look now are quite unsatisfactory because they just show, okay, if you put some a few hundred ppm of argon into starting material, you can dissolve it in perovskite. But it does not give you the real solubility. The solubility in the perovskite could actually be higher. We just cannot put so much argon into the starting material. So we started to do some different kind of experiment, which is much, much more difficult. We started to do two-stage gas loading experiments, where essentially, again, we make capsules directly for multi-anvil experiments. These are much smaller, therefore more difficult to make. Fill them with argon, then first we put these things into the stability field, not of perovskite in multi-anvil press, but of some other high-pressure phase like ringwoodite. converting into something like ringwoodite plus tissueite, then take out the capsule again, do a second multi-anvil experiment, and then convert this entire thing, still with the argon inside, into perovskite. Why do we do this in such a complicated way? Well, simply because you cannot do it in a simpler way. When you start with these glasses or whatever starting material, when you convert it into perovskite, there's such a large reduction of volume that pressure drops and you move out of the perovskite stability field. And the way to avoid this is first to make another high pressure assemblage, which is already quite dense, and only in the second stage of the experiment go into the perovskite stability field. And then sometimes you're successful. Very often you produce this. For example, some experiments, because you have to go to very high pressures, we have relatively large samples. There's a very high risk that that pretty much all of your tungsten carbide anvils which you use in experiment explode. And unfortunately, this has happened several times that all eight of these anvils exploded. Each of them costs a few thousand euros, so you're not getting very popular in the lab if you do such experiments. But it is very much worth to do this experiment, and I will show you now why. See, this here is a wonderful sample. This is a result of one of these two-stage gas loading experiments. You see huge gas bubbles here in the sample, huge gas bubbles. So this was certainly argon saturated. If you look at the sample in more detail, you see it's actually two phases. The majority here, what you see, is majorite. And there is absolutely nothing in this majorite. But these small grains here, at the grain boundary of the majorite, these are perovskite. And there is 3,000 ppm of argon in the perovskite. And we can do better than this. Here's another experiment. Very large grains of perovskite. 1.3 weight percent of argon homogeneously distributed in the perovskite. 1.3 weight percent. Okay. Now, when you see such result, immediate question is, where is here the argon? Well, again, we can get some insights into this simply by microprobe analysis. These are data. Argon concentration, or label somehow has disappeared, vertical axis is argon concentration plotted versus the silicon or magnesium ratio for two experiments. What you see is, as you reduce the silicon or magnesium ratio, which means you produce silicon vacancies, which must be charge balanced by oxygen vacancies, argon solubility shoots up. Okay? Again, the reason why you have this scatter in data is very simply the sample degasses under the electron beam. Okay? Another piece of evidence that is argon is really in the crystal structure, it's not some gunk sitting somewhere, is impurities in the crystal, is this here. We have taken some single crystal diffraction patterns, and if you look, okay, this here on the right-hand side, this is normal magnesium silicate perovskite without argon, and this is magnesium silicate perovskite with argon. If you look here, you see that, for example, this reflection here has quite different intensities in the two samples, and you can see such things when you look carefully around in the diffraction pattern at several places. So there's very clear evidence that there is really argon sitting in the crystal structure. Okay, now how about xenon? See, this is an experiment which we got almost 1 year ago, shortly before Christmas, and this looks like an illuminated Christmas tree here in some backscatter electron image. What is this? This is xenon under high pressure. These are bubbles still filled with high-density xenon. They sit below the surface of the sample, so they are not open. There's still xenon gas of high density in there, but because xenon is so heavy, you can see this in the backscatter electron image. But if you go away from these bubbles, here in the perovskite, away from bubbles, there's absolutely no xenon. Nothing detectable, despite the fact that there's no question that this sample was saturated with xenon. So, what is the explanation for this? I think the explanation is very simple. Okay, just look at the atomic radius of the noble gases. It's obvious that the argon is actually quite similar to the radius of oxygen vacancies, and therefore the argon fits very well into oxygen vacancies, while the xenon is simply too big, it won't fit in there. There is some independent piece of evidence which is supporting this idea that you can fill vacancies at high pressure very easily with noble gases if just the vacancies have the right sites. And it is something we just found by complete accident, because we did some experiment where we added some potassium carbonate as a flux in the hope to get bigger perovskite crystal for single crystal diffraction. And in these experiments, we observed some strange phase, something really strange. This is this thing here in the middle, strange composition, silicon, aluminum, magnesium, potassium, and again, half a weight percent of argon in there. What is this? It's a very strange phase, but it's known. This is phase X. It's an obscure phase. It's not stable in the mantle. It may be stable in some lithologies of the subducting slab. The structure of this phase is known, some strange layer structure. An interesting thing is this phase always has some deficiency in potassium, which means there are abundant potassium vacancies in this phase, always. And again, potassium, argon are neighbors in a periodic table. They have pretty much the same radius. So there's no surprise that this, again, is the only other phase which we have found in all lots of experiments, looking at various phases, which again takes argon in large quantities. And the nice thing about phase X is actually, unlike the perovskite, this phase X is quite stable under the electron beam. And so you can do wonderful things with this. Look at this. This is again the phase X, and this is just some X-ray image of argon distribution made by electron microprobe. And these argon concentrations are so outrageously high, you can just map out the argon with the electron microprobe just like you map out any other major element. And you can clearly see this is not some randomly distributed dirt or anything which we have in the sample. This is really selective substitution of argon in one phase where you have these vacancies where you can put in the argon. So what is the bottom line of this? I think the bottom line is under lower Mendel pressures, argon is by no means an incompatible element. It can easily be incorporated in all those phases, in particular in the magnesium silicate perovskite, which are known to contain oxygen vacancies. On the other hand, xenon is not incorporated in there because xenon is simply too big. And there is, in fact, there is in normal Mendel minerals, there is no site that would be suitable for taking xenon. So to come back at a question at the beginning, how did the xenon disappear? I think the answer is simple. At the beginning of Earth's history, there was a magma ocean, and this magma ocean must have crystallized at some point and must have fractionated perovskite. Okay, in this magma ocean, because it was originally in the equilibrium with a primitive atmosphere, there must have been noble gases dissolved in the magma ocean. When the perovskite crystallized, it took argon, but no xenon. At the same time, most of this primordial atmosphere was lost at the Earth's surface by heavy bombardment, high temperatures, things like this. All of this was gone. So you were left with some argon reservoirs somewhere deep in the Earth's interior. And later, when the Earth had solidified, vigorous convection, moving the perovskite out of its stability field, released the argon again. And therefore, you find today argon in the atmosphere, but not a xenon. So I would like to point out that what I'm saying here is very, very different from that what many other people have been saying before. Other people have been saying the xenon is not there because it's hiding somewhere. You just have to dig around somewhere and you will find it at some point. I'm saying just the opposite. The xenon is not there because it had no place to hide in early Earth history, while the argon could hide in the perovskite. What I'm also basically saying here is that when you're breathing and you're taking some sample of the atmosphere, you are actually still in this sample of the atmosphere today. You have some chemical fingerprint of the magma ocean and of the fractionation of silicate perovskite. And since I firmly believe in the importance of volatiles degassing from the Earth's interior, I finish with a picture of volatiles coming out of the mantle. Thank you very much.
Okay, I think we've got a little bit of time for some questions. Just try and get the lights up. So, right. I can't see anybody over there. Okay, two questions over here.
Well, okay. I mean, there are experimental data which show that actually the effect of something like chlorine on sorium mobility is negligible. There is no chlorine will not affect sorium. I'm not sure about beryllium. I simply don't have the data in my head. But for sorium, certainly this is not a problem. either you move it or you don't move it, but salinity will not make any difference. Well, if I remember correctly, the sodium partition coefficients, which I have been measuring some 15 years ago, I think I was saying that sodium will slightly partition into the fluid in both when you have no salt in there as well as when you have salt in there. So sodium is actually insensitive to halogens.
Okay. Another question there.
Yes.
It's not argon 36. Nobody has a clue of how much argon 36 is in the metal. Okay? What we're seeing is argon 40, which is produced by radiogenic growth. So it's really hard to make a strong statement about what argon is doing or has been doing in the metal.
Yes, but where are these data coming from? Basically, if I go back to I have to say I'm not a noble gas expert myself, so pretty much all of this is sort of new to me. But I mean, in lots of textbooks, you find these very nice pictures here which show this discrepancy between the consistency between the argon concentration in chondrite and in the bulk earth, and this large discrepancy for the xenon. Are you saying that these data for the argon are not reliable, or? Yes, but on the other hand, see, I would say, because if you look at available experimental data, I think one can be very sure that there will be no major reservoir in the upper mantle. I'm very sure about this. Okay. So if there is anything, I think it can only be in the lower mantle. Well, I have never been thinking about neon and helium, because my limited understanding of this noble gas business is that when you're going to some very light noble gases, you have losses by hydrodynamic escape. So this kind of argument which I'm here doing, that I'm basically explaining some argon xenon fractionation purely by magma ocean fractionation, I cannot use this argument to look at helium or neon, because helium or neon may have been lost to a large degree by hydrodynamic escape. So I have never seriously been thinking about this. However, what we did do is we recently did some experiment on krypton, but we have not measured this krypton experiment yet, so I cannot tell you now what krypton is doing.
Okay, we'll take two more questions and probably we should.
I was just going to ask about krypton, and then I thought we had an Al's question. So, but still, the question is, would you predict that neon, is neon too small to occupy that?
Okay, generally I would not expect any problem with krypton, because, okay, if you look at potassium and rubidium, generally there's little fractionation between potassium and rubidium, and the difference between argon and krypton is pretty much the same as the difference between potassium and rubidium. So for krypton, I suspect it will do the same thing like argon. With these lighter noble gases, I'm not sure. Okay, I just can't tell. Okay, the silicon vacancies, I think this is very well established. Okay, in the upper mantle, you have the perovskite buffered by periclase. And there are lots of studies which show that if you have buffering by periclase, okay, by MgO, then you have low silica activity and you get these silicon vacancies. But I can also show you, okay, we have, if you look at this experiment here, This is the experiment where we found this strange superhydrous phase X. This strange phase X. And in this experiment, where we have this phase X, we have perovskite coexisting with dischovite, so we have high silica activity. And in this experiment, we find absolutely no argon in the perovskite. And this again suggests, okay, if you have high silica activity, silicon positions are completely filled, you have no oxygen vacancies, you cannot put any argon in there. But, okay, in the upper mantle, of course, the perovskite is not in equilibrium with dischovite. Upper mantle, it's in equilibrium with periclase, and I mean, there are studies around, it's not something new which we are saying, which demonstrate that when you have the perovskite in equilibrium with the periclase, you must get the silicon vacancies and corresponding oxygen vacancies. I think this is nothing new. This is established.
Okay. Well, thanks very much to both.
And so.